I've heard people say, gee, I understand that Earth's climate has changed dramatically and rapidly in the past, so why should we care whether it changes now? Well, the answer to that is very simple. We happen to be here now. Complex human societies exist on the planet now. And those complex societies have never experienced extreme and rapid climate changes. Telling the story of climate change is a real challenge in an exhibit for several reasons. First of all, it's an enormously complicated subject. It's not just the science of how the climate system works, but it's also the potential consequences of warming, our ability to adapt, our efforts at mitigation and policy. It brings up issues of how we're going to deal with our energy future. These are all interwoven, intertwined issues, and they all emerge when you start talking about climate change.
The mission of the St. Louis Science Center is igniting and sustaining lifelong science and technology learning, because it's not just about kids anymore. We still need to get young people interested and excited about the future, but all of us need to be science literate. In fact, a third of our visitors are now adults who come by themselves looking for answers on the big issues that they read about on the front page of the newspaper every day. I think the public gets confused about climate change from what they see on the front page of the paper and what they see on television. It's not their job to sort out the scientific arguments. It's their job as citizens to have the general opinion about whether this is a serious issue or not, and listen to the people that are proposing solutions both in the political and science arena. We can help them understand those kinds of things. They come to us saying, does it really matter if I drive less? Does it really matter if I change my light bulbs? And what we're trying to do is give them the science facts as we know them, lay out the parameters, and then help them form their own opinions to be a responsible citizen.
What I'm focusing on most recently is the chemistry of atmospheric particles, which play an important role both in public health and in climate change. We know that as a consequence of human activities, the chemical composition of the atmosphere is changing. It's been strongly affected by emissions of greenhouse gases. We also know that the climate is changing all over the planet. Glaciers are melting, we have more intense hurricanes, we have droughts, we have floodings. The scientific community has reached the conclusion that these two observations are indeed connected. We're not absolutely certain that that's the case, but there's more than 90% probability, according to these very specific studies, that this is indeed the case. But fortunately, there are ways to reduce these emissions to the point that it's no longer as risky as it is today.
I work at the Field Museum for the Division of Environment, Culture, and Conservation. And we work both in the Chicago area and internationally on protecting and restoring natural ecosystems. I'm standing on Northerly Island, which is a park on the lakefront of Chicago. Until about 6 years ago, this was a small commuter airport. The ecosystem here is being restored to native prairie. Internationally, we mainly work in Peru on a national park called Cordillera Azul National Park, which is a huge area nearly the size of Connecticut that protects a tremendous amount of tropical forest. When those forests get cut down and they're burned, carbon that was stored in the trunks goes into the atmosphere as carbon dioxide and contributes to global warming.
The ice sheets covering Greenland contains a very unique record on the past climate. Every year snow falls on the Greenland ice sheet, and the following year it's covered by a new layer of snow. So when we drill ice cores down through the 3 kilometer thick ice, we get climate records reaching several hundred thousand years back in time. The ice cores has told us a lot about the past climate, but one of the things that I find is the most unique is that as snow is compressed to ice, we trap air bubbles in the ice. So we have samples of the past atmosphere trapped in the ice core. So when we discuss how the greenhouse gases have been changing and how the levels have been increasing, it's always ice core data that's used, because before 1958, where the observation net has been established, we only have the air bubbles from the ice cores to tell us about the levels of greenhouse gases.
21세기 우리 인류가 해결해야 될 가장 중요한 과제는 기후 변화라고 생각합니다. 특히 지구촌 전체 인구의 3분의 2가 살고 있는 아시아 지역에는 기후 변화로 인한 피해가 훨씬 심각합니다. 이러한 문제를 해결하는데 가장 중요한 것 중에 하나는 선진국이 신재생 에너지인 바람과 물과 태양을 이용하는 그러한 기술을 지원해 주는 거라고 생각합니다. 또 하나는 사막화된 현장에 나무를 많이 심어서 거기에 산소를 공급하고 CO2를 줄이는 그러한 노력을 해야 된다고 봅니다. 지구는 더 커지지 않기 때문에 우리의 생활 양식을 절제하면서 순환형 사회로 갈 수 있는 그러한 시스템을 만들어내야 된다고 생각을 합니다. 그렇게 해서 저는 작지만 아름답고 절제된 생활을 하면서 문화적인 쪽으로 가는 그러한 노력이 이 아시아 지역에서 더 확산되면은 저는 기후변화 문제도 해결할 수 있다고 생각합니다.
At the Green City Blue Lake Institute at the Cleveland Museum of Natural History, we are trying to be a clearinghouse of information and public education about all the ways that people can impact climate change. Everything from information about the best light bulbs to install in your house to how our cities can redesign their transportation systems so people can take transit and get out of their cars. Cleveland is an interesting place to work on environmental issues. Everyone knows about the burning of the Cuyahoga River back in 1969. That helped to kick off the modern environmental movement and the Clean Water Act. The Burning River is the icon that helped launch many environmental initiatives. We've come a long way since then. Now Cleveland is becoming one of the green cities of the future. We hope that the lessons we've learned here in Northeast Ohio can be applied around the world.
On my own personal point of view, it's becoming very clear for scientists and also for the general public that climate change is already with us. It's caused by anthropogenic emissions. Humanity have some very important and very critical actions to take into several aspects to have a stable climate along this century. One of them is to reduce deforestation very strongly, especially in Amazonia. Another one is to reduce the emissions of fossil fuels very significantly if you want to have a stable climate in the future.
I hope people come out with an understanding that the climate is already changing, that those changes are by and large due to human activity, the burning of fossil fuels, the cutting of burning of rainforests, and the emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases. I hope they'll understand that the buildup of the gases in the atmosphere is largely irreversible in a human time frame. So decisions we're making today will affect our children, our grandchildren, and future generations for a long, long time to come. If we act promptly, we can, in all likelihood, stabilize the climate eventually at a level that will avoid dangerous outcomes. This problem is more than a scientific curiosity to me, after all. I take it personally because I love the environment, and I hate to see big chunks of it go down the drain because we're incautious about the junk that we're throwing into the atmosphere. And most of all, I have two young children, and I don't want to pass along a world to them that I myself wouldn't want to live in.